His team is still very much interested in learning what the president knew about certain issues and possible collusion and obstruction of justice. And it signals that potentially this investigation is far from over. As we know, an interview hasn't happened. There has been ongoing negotiations between the president's team and Robert Mueller's team. But I'm told by a source familiar that the president is vacillating in terms of a possible interview. As you know, he has said publicly that he wants to sit down with Robert Mueller under oath and do an interview. But as it becomes more clear that the Russia probe is nowhere near wrapping up, it seems, the president is sort of changing his posture in terms of an interview. And we also saw that spill over on Twitter over the weekend when he went after Robert Mueller by name for the first time, Anderson.
Yeah, I understand. You're also learning more about what was behind all the tweets the president was sending out this weekend.
That's right. I'm told by a couple sources that the president is growing increasingly agitated because he's realizing what he's been told by his own lawyers, that this is going to wrap up soon. We heard last year it was going to be November, then December. Here we are in mid-March, and there's all these signs that it isn't going to wrap up anytime soon. So as he is realizing this and that his lawyers have told him isn't really happening, he's growing increasingly frustrated, essentially, and that is one of the reasons he went on Twitter to go after Robert Mueller by name. Also, the fact that just recently Robert Mueller's team subpoenaed the Trump Organization for business records, that also sort of added to this feeling that this is not going to wrap up anytime soon. And as you know, the president is very eager for this too, and as it becomes more clear that that is not happening, the president is growing more angry by the day, Anderson.
And the new attorney that the president has hired, what do we know about him?
Right. Well, as you'll recall, just, what, a week ago, the president said there was no plan to hire anyone to his legal team. He said this on Twitter. And then just today, we learned that, in fact, Joe DiGeneva, who is a former U.S. attorney in D.C., longtime Washington lawyer, will be added to the legal team very soon. Now, his role is seen as someone to do more of the PR, to sort of speak to the media and speak publicly for the president. So he is someone, though, Anderson, who is known to peddle conspiracy theories. He said as recently as January that he believes FBI agents concocted the Russia investigation to prevent Trump from becoming president. Obviously, the president liked what he heard. He likes Joe DiGeneva, and now he's hired on the legal team, it appears, Anderson.
All right, Pamela Brown, thanks very much. As you know, the House Intelligence Committee is no longer in the Russia investigation business, Republicans having pulled the plug, with now a Democratic member of the committee, Congressman Eric Swalwell of California. So, Congressman, in light of the president's direct criticism of Mueller and the investigation, are you concerned that Mueller's days as special counsel could be numbered?
Anderson, I've been long concerned that Bob Mueller's days are numbered and that the president is not the only one who is trying to limit them, that he has a number of my colleagues, Republican colleagues in Congress, all the way up to Paul Ryan, who are enabling the ouster of Bob Mueller. So look, you know, the president can hire 100 lawyers, but there's only one version of the truth. So it's time for him to tell that version, end the games, and just come clean with the American people.
You've said that Congress should immediately vote to protect Mueller. Some of your Republican colleagues over the weekend warned that there'd be serious consequences if the president did go so far as to fire him. But, I mean, is there any real appetite from Republicans to take legislative action to try to protect Mueller?
No, Anderson. Actions speak louder than Sunday morning shows or tweets. And all I hear from my Republican colleagues every time the president attacks Mueller, calls the investigation a hoax, or fires somebody who knows something is, you know, good talk. But we actually are not helpless. We can put into law and cement Bob Mueller's role and also make sure that he could only be removed if a panel of independent judges thought that he should be removed for cause. That's the best thing we could do, and we need leadership right now from Paul Ryan and Mitch McConnell on that.
I want to read something that you tweeted to the president over the weekend after McCabe's firing. You wrote, quote, "Gloat now, but you will be fired soon, and it's not going to be done cowardly as you've done so many who served you. There's a storm gathering, Mr. President, and it's going to wipe out you and your corrupt organization all the way down to these studs." You really believe that?
Yeah, I do, and I actually probably should have put an S after storm. There are storms gathering. I think the best outcome for the American people is if a check is put on this presidency this midterm, and then that he is impeached at the ballot box in 2020. But by his own actions, he's inviting obstruction of justice charges, both in the criminal courts and also, I believe, to the House Judiciary Committee.
The fact that the president's team has hired a lawyer who's alleged that the president is being framed by a group of FBI and DOJ officials, what does that say you think about the president's legal strategy going forward?
Well, there's no floor of the FBI building that they are not willing to torch, to peddle their conspiracy theories. And for me, as the son of a cop and the brother to two cops, it just really offends me that he would just project upon all police officers that they are politicizing their investigations and that they're out to get him. He ran on being the police-friendly candidate, and right now, just to protect himself, he and his allies keep attacking the cops. I think that's wrong, but that seems to be the legal strategy. And Anderson, as a former prosecutor, when you don't have the facts or the law on your side, you put the government on trial, and that's what I'm seeing right now.
Congressman Swalwell, I appreciate your time. I want to bring in our panel.
My pleasure.
Gloria Borger, also Ryan Lizza, Michael Caputo, Robbie Mook, Ann Milgram, and Asha Rangappa. Gloria, I mean, does it seem to you that we're entering sort of a new phase, particularly with the president's tweets, the new lawyer?
Oh, it does. This is the Donald Trump phase of the Donald Trump defense. This is being run by the president. He's the one who wanted Joe DiGenova in. I think this was not welcomed warmly by John Dowd, who was leading the interactions with Mueller.
We should point out the president just last week said, I think it was fake news, the idea that he was going to bring on another lawyer.
Right. And I think this reflects the president's feeling that the strategy, which was the Dowd strategy and the Ty Cobb strategy, which was kind of, Mr. President, hold on here, mind your manners, don't tweet about Mueller, this is going to be over. Just hold on, and suddenly the president looks at the subpoena for the Trump Organization. He looks at these questions that Pamela and I are reporting, and he says, whoa, you guys are wrong, and I need to start pushing back and discrediting Mueller right now.
Well, Michael, I mean, if the president's attorneys told him that this thing was going to be wrapped up in Thanksgiving or New Year's, I mean, it's understandable he would be annoyed by that.
Certainly, and I think also, I mean, let's not forget the terrible end game in south of Pittsburgh in that congressional special election last week. It doesn't look good for the Republicans in 2018, the midterm elections. And if, in fact, we lose control of the House of Representatives, the president will most certainly face impeachment, no matter what comes out of any of these investigations. And I think, you know, adding to Geneva is a good idea. I also believe that they need to be looking at working the jury. I mean, it's unique to the American system that this is an actual, the jury, the House of Representatives, they can actually start having a charm offensive and bringing them in and talking to them. Because I think the more we look at 2018, the midterms, the worse it looks for the Republican Party.
Robbie, how do you see it?
Well, I agree with Gloria. I think the major development that happened is the Trump Organization itself is now under threat. And I think that financial risk to the president is what's striking deep. It's also his family.
You think
that
that's what changed, sort of launched the president?
I do. I think that really triggered something different, because up until now he was able to obfuscate with conspiracy theories and so on. But at the point that there are true financial connections between his company and Russia, or at the point that we can fill in the motivations perhaps for coordinating or cozying up to Putin, i.e., building the hotel in Moscow. He doesn't have much more to grasp at that point. So I think that's a big change. I would also posit, I don't know that Democrats are going to give Trump the gift of trying to impeach him right away. I think the smart thing for Democrats to do is subpoena, which nobody has done, subpoena his taxes, subpoena his administration, bring those guys in every day and ask them the hard questions.
You say it would be a gift? Why?
Because it gives the president the opportunity, who, by the way, will be running for re-election, to say all the Democrats want to do is rip me out of office. I don't think we should give him that luxury. I think we should hold him accountable for his behavior, hold his administration accountable for how they have pillaged the government.
He'll still say it, by the way.
But it's interesting that this has been brought up. I bet the president will start alleging this. They're trying to impeach me. They're trying to impeach me. Let's wait and see what the Democrats decide to do. I bet they'll just end up subpoenaing.
I mean, Ryan, it is, you know, reminiscent of the campaign when candidate Trump kept talking about a rigged system. I mean, that seems to be sort of now this, that all the institutions are rigged against him.
They're all rigged against him. That's probably why he liked this new lawyer who has been on Fox News saying that the entire investigation is rigged and it's a conspiracy at the FBI to frame Donald Trump. And look, this legal team, as Gloria has been reporting, has been divided for months now between those on the sort of Ty Cobb wing of the team who wants cooperation, no crazy tweets, and the other side of the team who has been, and some of the outside political advisors who've been saying, you got to go out there, you got to do what Caputo's saying, you got to work the refs, you have to attack Mueller. And Trump has obviously switched after listening to the sort of moderating forces and the sort of Washington wise men, legal types. He's now taking the advice of the more radicalizing legal advisors.
And I mean, you were Attorney General in New Jersey. Did you question whether your investigators' personal political beliefs would color their investigative abilities or their judgment? Because that's what
he's saying, right?
What they're saying.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think that is the allegation here. But, you know, I've been a local prosecutor in New York. I was a federal prosecutor at the Department of Justice. I was a state attorney general, and I ran a police department in Camden, New Jersey. And I can tell you that I never knew the political affiliation of a single officer or agent that I worked with. You know, it wasn't an issue. And I'm sure I worked with Democrats and Republicans, but we didn't talk politics. And so I do think this is part of a larger strategy, really, to discredit the investigation. And it happens to be that the FBI and Robert Mueller and his team are the ones standing in the way. And so they're the ones being attacked as institutions and as people.
Asha, I mean, as a former FBI person, I mean, do you bristle at the idea that FBI agents can't separate their personal political beliefs from doing their job?
Absolutely. I echo what Ann said. I didn't know who voted for whom. And this was after a controversial election in 2000. So it just wasn't talked about. I think the president is now facing the reality that there is really no good way out at this moment. This investigation is moving like Burnham Wood toward the White House. And as Gloria mentioned before, there's a subpoena to the Trump Organization. There's the questions that Mueller wants to ask. He now knows that McCabe had written memos. And his legal team, in addition to giving him false promises, have probably also told him, I mean, they probably made it clear that he could get into trouble with this interview, that he can't talk his way out of it the way he did with the New York Times or when he goes on, you know, talks to the press. So I'm sure that makes him very nervous. And he thinks that he can win this in the court of public opinion, and that way he doesn't have to fight it in a court of law.
And if he doesn't testify, he has to have a good reason for it. Mm-hmm. And the reason is, why would I testify before these corrupt people?
And just for a reality check on this too, you know, if we look before Election Day, I don't want to relitigate the election, but the FBI wasn't doing Hillary Clinton any favors. I mean, arguably, the FBI was really coming down pretty hard on Hillary, talking about her investigation when they refused to talk about Trump's, the Comey sending those letters, all the leaks that were pouring out of their New York field office. So all of a sudden on Election Day, the FBI changes their political views. I mean, it doesn't make sense.
We've got to take a quick break. Much more to talk about, including more on the president's newest attorney and the theories he believes about the FBI trying to keep Donald Trump from becoming president. Later, are congressional Republicans trying to warn the president against firing Robert Mueller, while at the same time, as Congressman Swalwell puts it, actually enabling him. You'll have a chance to hear what they have to say so you can decide for yourself. There's breaking news tonight. Both sides in the Russia probe hashing out the details of the possible questioning of a sitting president. As we learn more about that, we're also learning about the newest member of the president's legal team, or rediscovering it. Joseph DeGeneva, after all, is not a new face in Washington. However, his hiring could signal something of a new direction for the president's defense. Randy Kaye has more.
They didn't like Donald Trump. They didn't think he was fit to be president.
That's Joe DeGeneva, a regular TV pundit, and the man President Donald Trump is adding to his legal team in the Russia probe. He's the same Joe DeGeneva who has in recent months pushed the theory that the FBI and the Justice Department were working to frame Trump, fabricating the Russia investigation in an effort to keep Trump out of the Oval Office. Evidence to support that theory is scant, yet still, his notion is based in part on thousands of text messages exchanged between two FBI officials.
Everything that we have seen from these texts and from all the facts developing shows that the FBI and senior DOJ officials conspired to violate the law and to deny Donald Trump his civil rights.
DeGeneva is just one of the conservative TV personalities Trump has brought on board. He joins former CNBC contributor Larry Kudlow and former Fox anchor Heather Nauert, now fourth in line at the State Department, not to mention all the other Fox anchors Trump leans on for advice.
DeGeneva and his wife, meanwhile, have their own law firm in Washington, D.C., Before opening the firm, he served as the U.S. attorney in the District of Columbia. Most of his focus has been on cases involving corruption and fraud.
The hiring of DeGeneva may all be part of a more aggressive approach. DeGeneva is expected to engage the media and mount a strong defense of the president. Often, DeGeneva delivers personal attacks, sounding a lot like the president himself. Listen.
FBI has lost almost all of its credibility and, regrettably, its integrity as a result of the conduct of James Comey, who remains America's most dirty cop.
Whatever you may think of Loretta Lynch, and she was a lowly attorney general by virtue of her conduct.
Like Trump, one of DeGeneva's favorite targets is Hillary Clinton.
There was a brazen plot to illegally exonerate Hillary Clinton, and if she didn't win the election, to then frame Donald Trump with a falsely created crime.
He slammed President Barack Obama, too.
He has become a man drunk with power, abusive of the Constitution, and lawless.
Back in 1997, Joseph DeGeneva once wrote a Wall Street Journal op-ed related to then-President Bill Clinton, saying an independent counsel should not be reluctant to prosecute based on some vague concept of presidential immunity, adding, it would teach the valuable civics lesson that no one is above the law. Words that may come back to haunt him and his client. Randy Kay, CNN, New York.
Back now with the panel. Michael, do you think he's a good choice for the president's
I like Joe DeGeneva. I always have. I'm going to have difficulty getting used to this turtleneck look that he brings to Tony. But I'll get past that, I suppose. I mean, I think that the president sees that the kind of optimistic view that his attorneys were sharing with him in at the end of 2017, the beginning of 2018, is not in fact true. And I think he believes more what Joe DeGeneva is saying. I think between the three of them, they're going to give him a pretty solid representation.
It's interesting. I mean, the choices the president seems to be making, Larry Kudlow, people with television experience who may be able, maybe he's looking for sort of more people out there defending him.
Sure. Jay Sekulow, one of his attorneys, has been out there. But he's also trying to do this case. And so it's difficult. I think DeGeneva will be part of the legal team and not just part, I'm told, not just part of a spokesman team. I think that it has not been well received by John Dowd, the way this was rolled out. And, you know, the president did it in a sort of a way that's Trumpian. And Dowd has been the major communicator with Bob Mueller. And I think this is going to cause a little bit of difficulty internally. And so you have Dowd who says, you know, we've got to be careful, even though he tweeted over the weekend, I think at the president's prodding. He tweeted at Mueller at the president's prodding. And then you have DeGeneva, who's very aggressive, but he's a former U.S. attorney. So he has a stature that Dowd does to counter Dowd. And I think that's probably what the president was looking for here.
If you are a white male in your 60s and 70s and are a conservative TV pundit, you have a very high chance of getting a job in the current administration.
TV should disqualify you.
No, nothing wrong with TV pundits. They're, you know, some of the best working yet. But, I mean, the Kudlow and DeGeneva, he's watching cable news and picking his staff now based on the people and how much they defend him.
You think that's really how he's doing it?
Absolutely. I mean, there's no doubt about it. We know it's been reported quite frequently that he watches hours of cable news a day.
Right.
The way to get in front of him, the way to get a policy issue in front of him is to go on Fox News and talk about it. We have examples of lobbyists actually successfully doing this. There's no doubt about it. He's watching DeGeneva and is one of the few lawyers out there that is willing to spin a kind of these sort of crazy conspiratorial ideas about, you know, deep state trying
What's
to
so
frame.
Crazy about it?
No facts, Michael, he's saying that the Justice Department and the FBI are framing Donald Trump.
Well,
what's the evidence of that?
Then we find out that Strzok and Page were texting back and forth about getting in front of a judge who, you know, I guess it was Contreras is his name, and then Contreras goes ahead and recuses himself from the Flynn case.
So, Michael, these indictments that have been brought, Michael Flynn, what they had on George Papadopoulos, the 13 Russians, all of that was just framed by the FBI.
Oh, no, not
this
at
is,
all. Not
this
at all.
Is Berman I believe, and the glove with OJ.
I believe Papadopoulos lied to the FBI. I believe that General Flynn got crossways with the FBI in his interview. I believe that those Russians needed to be
indicted. So you believe there are real
crimes? I believe that the Russians were messing with our election in a low-level way on Facebook and Twitter and et cetera. I believe all of those things are legit. But in the end, when you say that DeGeneva is completely off base, saying that that there is some kind of a conspiracy to go after Donald Trump, I think you're ignoring what we see in the kind of post-Obama American democracy, and that is that the American people can elect whoever they want as president. But if that president goes against the whims of the elite in Washington, D.C., they're going to do everything they can to destroy him.
I believe,
and that's what DeGeneva believes, and that's what I believe.
John Dowd believes that too, by the way. John Dowd believes the same thing Joe DeGeneva believes. The difference is this is a media strategy. John Dowd has always said, go dark on the media. The media is irrelevant. The president believes the media is not irrelevant. The president watches the media. He's a consumer. He plays in that arena. And he wants somebody who says, no, you know what? We gotta turn them around, and the media is not irrelevant. So I think Dowd and DeGeneva are on the same page that way.
We got to get another quick break. One of the most understated men in Washington, a former CIA director, weighs in with an outspoken attack tweet on the president of the United States. Also tonight, why Stormy Daniels' attorney believes it's strange the president has stayed silent about their legal fight and what we know about the judge who will take up the federal lawsuit when 360 continues. As we mentioned, the president tweeted up a storm over the weekend, and John Brennan, the former CIA director under President Obama, also took to Twitter, not just to blast the president's firing of Andrew McCabe, but to blast the president personally. Quote, when the full extent of your venality, moral turpitude, and political corruption becomes known, you will take your rightful place as a disgraced demagogue in the dustbin of history. You may scapegoat Andy McCabe, but you will not destroy America. America will triumph over you. We're back now with the panel. Asha, I mean, pretty harsh words from John Brennan there.
Yeah, and, you know, let's remember that he was a part of the early stages of, you know, some of this investigation. He's the one who called his, or, you know, met or called his counterpart in Russia to say, stand down this operation that you're doing. That's the level that it went to. That's not a normal spy-to-spy kind of thing. So he knows at least some background of maybe what was going on, which is kind of the context against which I read that, because those were very strong words that he used against the president.
To Trump supporters, though, is that just evidence of a deep state?
Well, what's evidence of maybe of the deep state is that Samantha Powers quoting that tweet and saying, whatever you do, don't piss off, you know, Brennan. I mean, at the end of all of this, we see the most political director of the CIA in modern times going after a president of the United States, and we've never seen that. As far as I know, in my lifetime, I've never seen a former CIA director go after a sitting president. And for Trump supporters, it smells bad. And you can't blame him for it because this is unprecedented.
And do you see it as unprecedented?
So, I mean, it certainly is not common. It's not something we've seen often. But Brennan has been outspoken, I think, since the election. And he has been very forthright in saying that the Russians hacked the election, that there's
as
a serious,
has Michael Hayden,
exactly,
Jack Clapper.
Exactly, that there's a serious national security issue. And so I think, you know, he has been out there and basically saying, look, this is a huge issue for the United States of America. He's a little bit hamstrung because a lot of the information he has, he can't share. But I think what we're seeing is his conclusions of frustration.
I think in a way, though, doesn't this play into Donald Trump, or who can then say, look at how political the former CIA director is. Look at how political the former DNI is. Look, these guys were out to get me with the dodgy dossier and everything else. That by tweeting this, and, you know, I don't deny Brennan's right to say whatever he wants to say, but in a way, it does kind of give Donald Trump more ammunition.
Well, and this is the classic Donald Trump double standard. We're talking about people using forceful words against Donald Trump. It is Donald Trump who is always insulting all of these guys, and he has been doing it for months,
right,
maybe even at this point years. So the idea that Donald Trump, it's not fair for people to use strong language to criticize him is absurd.
I don't think it's not fair. I just think y'all got to, you know, buck up and buckle up, because this is the way it's going to be. If Brennan and Powers and all these others are going after Donald Trump, you can't expect him to sit on his hands.
Well, they're going after the truth is what I would say. They're not going after Donald Trump. They're going after the truth.
Sounds like he's gone after Donald Trump. I mean, you can say it's truthful,
but this is an important point, actually. I think he is trying to clear the way and keep minds and heads level about what's really going on here. The point is, every time you pursue the truth with Donald Trump, every time you try to set up the facts to establish what is actually going on, you are attacked in this way. And I think that's what he's standing up to. And I don't like that that's the way things have gotten to in this country, but it's where we are.
That's the thing that bothers me a little bit about it is, I mean, you could never criticize someone for speaking their mind, as you said, and telling the truth. And it's kind of fascinating to see that this is what Brennan actually believes. But I can't skip the sense of like, this is another example of how Twitter has just destroyed public discourse. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we only have a few senior officials who oversaw and saw up close the Russian meddling in the 2015-16 period. And I think some of these officials, to maintain their authority on this issue, it might be better for them to take a step back and not get into, you know, political pissing matches with the president, as hard as that may be.
It is interesting. There's that, you know, it's the thing Marco Rubio faced in the campaign is, do you fight back in a way, you know, that Donald Trump fights back, or does it make you look... you're not going to do it as well as he does it, and it makes you, you know, look sullied.
He drives everyone to that point.
I totally agree with your point, and I think you're making an important point. I will just say, having been on the campaign end of this, boy, when you just let Donald Trump keep throwing it at you and you try to stand strong and be the mature adult, the bad child always wins. We've seen this
so many times before. But it's different for a campaign and the former head of the CIA. He was someone, I shouldn't say was.
He's defending his reputation, though, in fairness. I get it.
Also, in the wake of McCabe being fired, and I think that there is, you know, I think we're all wondering, is Mueller next? So, you know, we also have to say that it was a forceful words to basically say that would, like, you're really trying to cover
something
up. But
he's defending his institution, and this is the problem. You have one institution attacking another institution, and that's what we're watching every day here. And that's what's so disconcerting to people, because we're used to these people kind of saying, well, we're all working for the common good. And
let's get a quick break in. More with the panel ahead. We're going to hear from some reaction from Capitol Hill about the idea the president will once again consider firing the special counsel, Robert Mueller. What congressional Republicans are saying about that next. After a weekend of the president lashing out at special counsel Robert Mueller and his team on Twitter, the question once again looms large. Will the president try to fire him? On the Hill, members of Congress are warning that would not be a good idea, including some Republicans. Take a look.
The only reason Mr. Mueller could ever be dismissed is because for cause. I see no cause when it comes to Mr. Mueller.
I like Bob Mueller. He's honest. He's a very good prosecutor. It would be the stupidest thing the president could do.
I think it would be a total upheaval in the Senate if that were to happen.
When you are innocent, if the allegation is collusion with the Russians, and there is no evidence of that, and you're innocent of that, act like it.
This is serious. Firing the special prosecutor?
Can you say Saturday Night Massacre? No, it would not be a smart thing to do.
The leader may say, well, he's not going to do that. They've said they're not going to do that. A couple of weeks ago, he said he wasn't firing Tillerson.
It would be an Archibald Cox moment, just as there was during Watergate.
Preemptively, we ought to say that again, don't do it. Don't go there. That's a red line you cannot cross.
How many of those are running again?
Not many.
How many of those support Donald Trump?
All of them. They're not running. So it's not a little profile and courage there. But I would say about legislation, you know, the president would have
Lindsey
to sign
Graham
it.
Is, but...
The president. Oh, Lindsey is right. Lindsey Graham is. The president would have to sign this legislation.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't go anywhere anyway, because then you'd need to override the veto, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that Republicans don't want to touch it. They just don't want to touch it. When they're forced to touch it, this is how brave they are. When they're forced to touch it, they will. But right now, they see no need to. The leaders don't want to. They want to pick their fights with the president, and this is not one they're going to take on.
But he does this every few months with Mueller. He puts out feelers to see what the market on Capitol Hill will bear.
That's what John Dowd's tweet was.
That's right, exactly. It's to see how many of these Republicans are stepping forward and saying, don't do that, that's a red line. And for months now, that has been the red line. But, I mean, as you mentioned, this was a sort of roundup of the usual suspects on the Hill, Republicans who have been very outspoken against Trump. And you don't see Paul Ryan saying anything. You don't see McConnell saying anything. And the fewer Republicans who speak up, the more Donald Trump thinks, huh, maybe I can get away with this after all.
Yeah. Please go ahead.
No, I just think it's amazing. I think history will judge them so harshly. I don't know what to say. And I think it's going to make it harder for them. We talked about this last week. The more the Republicans pull back and refuse to let this go where it needs to go, the more momentum Democrats are going to have when, knock on wood, they win back the House and have subpoena power. They're creating the space. What's that?
That's not wood.
Oh, yeah, well, glass, whatever. I'll knock on some wood later.
I just think all the hand-wringing over Donald Trump's tweets is a little bit hilarious to me. I think what the president is doing and what he did with these tweets over the weekend is he's trying to define the terms of the conversation when it comes to the Mueller investigation. But in addition to that, unusually...
And he's doing that.
He is. But he's also trying to define the parameters of the interview. And I think if you watch the president's tweets in the days forward, you're going to see that more and more happening.
Do you think the president's tweets have an impact on Mueller?
So I think a couple of things. I mean, I think the president's tweets over the weekend were like the greatest hits of complaints, right? I mean, it was sort of like one after the other after the other. And from a legal perspective, the issue, I think, is this interview. And look, he's setting it up to say the entire investigation is not legitimate, which gives him the ability to say, I'm not even walking in, right? And so that's what I think also potentially with the new lawyer is, you know, he's going to become a lot more aggressive publicly on this. And then he may put himself in the position of saying, they're going to ask me about things I've already told them or not, I have no knowledge about.
But he can be subpoenaed.
He can be subpoenaed. And, you know, Gloria and I talked about this a little bit before. He absolutely can be subpoenaed. I personally think that the special counsel will need to talk to Bob Mueller. Sorry, will need to talk to the president. I do not see how Mueller can finish this investigation without talking to the president. I think he will bend over backwards to make it voluntary. My personal view is that if he won't walk in voluntary, then Mueller will subpoena the president, because I don't think, if this is a search for the truth, I don't see how you would want to end an investigation like this without hearing the president's side of the story. And Twitter, to me, does not count.
But his lawyers will fight that
completely.
They will completely take that to the Supreme Court. And, you know, the downside for them is that this prolongs.
Exactly.
It prolongs everything. But I think they would do it anyway.
I agree. I believe. They would fight it.
Much more with the panel ahead. We got to get the latest news in the Stormy Daniels case, what her lawyer is now saying about the president's silence on the issue.